We'll put a gun in every Taiwanese household, train them how to use it. That is how you make Xi Jinping think twice.
Do you really think that would be a sufficient plan to deter a Chinese invasion if it includes long-range missiles, ground troops, an aerial blockade, a naval blockade?
Kaitlan, all of the different measures here?
Republican presidential candidate Vivek Ramaswamy had a contentious interview with CNN's Kaitlan Collins over his suggestion that arming the people of Taiwan with firearms could potentially help them defend themselves against an invasion by China. Now let's watch more of that conversation, how it went down, and then we'll talk about the reality.
Kaitlan, of course it's not sufficient. You take that tiny little clip when I've articulated at the Nixon Library last week, a 1 hour speech with a whole range of deterrents. That is part of it. But I've also said that I would pull Russia out of its military alliance with China. I've also said that we would bolster our partnership with India to be able to close the Andaman Sea and the Malacca Strait. I've also said that we would actually send a signal very clearly that we will defend Taiwan, moving from strategic ambiguity to strategic clarity to say that we will defend Taiwan until we have semiconductor independence in this country. And so yes, part of this is turning Taiwan into a porcupine. I think exporting our Second Amendment is a relatively free or low cost way to do that. But I find it laughable that you will take that clip and then put words into my mouth as though that was a sufficient deterrent. Kaitlan, with due respect, that's a joke. I will not allow someone to put words in my mouth I ever said that was sufficient.
I'm not putting words in your mouth. I'm simply asking about something you said. We played a quote that you've made. Speaking of another comment that you've made.
I never said it was sufficient.
So I went into his full speech at the Nixon Library, and he's actually telling the truth, hyper-focusing on what to me was more of like a throwaway statement or something to kind of like attract potentially campaign donations from the NRA. It's just not it's not really a good representation of something more comprehensive that he shared during that speech about his foreign policy. You might disagree with his foreign policy, and honestly, I think that what he actually said during his speech, some parts of it were incredibly naive, and we can get into that. But I wanna provide the receipts and show you what he actually said during that speech. Before I do, briefly, Cenk, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, so I was set to disagree with him because I think he put that part in the speech, both to appeal to the base and to get the media to talk about it because it's so outrageously stupid, in my opinion. But once I watched the speech and the interview, I think that he is right about the core of what he's saying, which is he didn't say sufficient. Mm-hmm. And saying sufficient changes the entire tenor of what he was saying.
So let's get into what he actually said during his speech. I think it's actually interesting, maybe a discussion about foreign policy and whether or not he's right. So during that speech, again, it was last week at the Nixon Library. He said that one of the first things he wanted to do was end the war in Ukraine. He says that he refuses to use the resources of the United States on the Russian invasion in Ukraine when we should be using our resources on the invasion on our southern border. So right off the bat, obviously, I disagree with his framing there entirely. But nonetheless, he also would stop arming Ukraine, which would force Ukraine to give up territory like the Donbas region and essentially agree to like some sort of peace agreement with Putin. And then he would agree to do something else that he claims Russia wants. So let's take a look at that.
The Russia-China alliance represents the single greatest military threat that we face in the US today. I will end the Ukraine war on terms that require Vladimir Putin to exit his military alliance with China. The deal I will do with Vladimir Putin is simple. We will freeze the current lines of control. We will further make a hard commitment that NATO will never admit Ukraine to NATO. I will require that Russia exit its military alliance with China. I will require that Russia remove its nuclear weapons from Kaliningrad, the strip of Russia that borders Poland. And I will require, pursuant to my modern Monroe Doctrine, that Russia remove its military presence in the Western Hemisphere, not in Cuba, not in Venezuela, not in Nicaragua, you're out. And in return, we will reopen economic relations with Russia, just as Nixon did with China.
Now, cutting off Russia economically with economic sanctions has not been persuasive to Putin. Keep that in mind. I think that it's naive to think that if we make a commitment to preventing Ukraine from joining NATO, that Putin would agree to like end his alliance with China. That's the area where I think Vivek Ramaswamy is being incredibly naive. But he does think that if he succeeds in that, in basically having Russia end its alliance with China, that would have an impact on China's foreign policy in Taiwan. So I want to go to the next video and then we'll get your thoughts, Cenk. Let's watch.
The argument goes that if Putin walks away with parts of the Donbas region, that will somehow cause Xi Jinping to be emboldened to think he can walk away with impunity if he takes a piece of Taiwan. I think it's actually the reverse that's true. Today we are driving Russia further into China's hands. And Xi Jinping's calculus is that the US will not want to go into conflict with two different allied nuclear superpowers, Russia and China, at the same time. But if Russia is no longer in China's camp, is no longer a 2001 treaty ally as they are today, then Xi Jinping will have to think twice before going after Taiwan.
Okay, so very curious what you think about his foreign policy so far. Before I go to you though, clearly he's talking about a lot more than just arming the people of Taiwan, right? So relevant to the conversation with Kaitlan Collins. Cenk, what do you think?
So first I'm gonna tell you three things that I think Vivek's wrong about and then three things that the media is wrong about in covering him. So in terms of the foreign policy speech, there's three layers to it. First one is fairly standard Republican talking points now about freezing the action where it is now, basically giving Donbas to the Russians and stopping all aid to Ukraine. I don't agree with it at all, but it's not crazy. I mean, it is crazy in my opinion, but it's not crazy to Republicans. It's perfectly normal within Republican circles. Then he gets into these fun ideas about, oh, we're gonna get Russia to withdraw from Cuba and Venezuela, etc. And we're gonna get them out of the area next to Poland. Yeah. And we're gonna do this grand deal with China. Totally, utterly unrealistic, not how diplomacy works.
You don't think that'll be enticing to Vladimir Putin?
Yeah, I'm sure he's this close to it. Besides which, the whole thing's based on a fantasy that we're gonna get into a military conflict with Russia and China, that they're gonna gang up on us. They're not gonna start a giant war against us. We're not worried about it. We're worried about, hey, are we gonna have regional conflicts that start to spiral out of control, like Taiwan, Ukraine, etc. But he makes it sound like as if they're going to attack us all at once. China sells to us more than they sell to anyone. They would ruin their own economy if they got into a significant conflict with America. So look, I don't think any of that makes any sense. I think it's a little childish, but that's a disagreement. Republicans have to go radical these days. If you just do a normal, logical diplomatic solution offer, the Republican base will hate it, right? So, okay, now, but the third layer is this, let's arm the Taiwanese with AR-15s. Now, that's so over the top and ridiculous that it's meant to draw media attention. It's meant to, it's like he's catfishing. He's like, oh yeah, and then I'm gonna give all the folks in Taiwan AR-15s and hand grenades. Come on, media, anybody out there, anybody out there? And by the way, I respect the you know, hate the game, don't hate the player, right? I respect what he's doing. In fact, the Just Democrats should do it, but with rational things. He's saying, shiny object, come attack. Now, then he's gonna say, hey, I got this thing where we're gonna give up on Ukraine and we're gonna support the Russians, and the Republican voters like that, right? So it's a fine strategy in terms of optics and politics. It's terrible on the policy. But what is the media reaction? Instead of bringing it down like we just did. Okay, so Kaitlan Collins says, so you think just giving guns to the Taiwanese is sufficient? But he didn't say sufficient.
No.
He laid out a 48-minute speech where that was a small part of the whole thing. And when you frame it that way, in a dishonest way, then it's manna from heaven for him. Because then he gets to be a victim of the media too.
That's exactly right.
Right?
That's exactly right.
So you're feeding right into him. He could, like, if I'm on Vivek's team, I love how that went. Right?
Totally.
Yes, absolutely. Now I'm the hero fighting back against CNN, and I caught him in a lie.
By the way,
right?
And by the way, look, honestly, at this point, I don't trust CNN. I don't trust any legacy media organization on reporting all of the facts as I'm reading or watching what they're putting out into the world, right? Which is why now, like, you have to go to the source material. This is what they're claiming about his speech. Go watch his speech and figure out whether or not they're telling the truth, right? Because again, that was one tiny line or one tiny part of this lengthy speech. He even got into the third part of this, which was how he would get India involved in helping to essentially protect Taiwan from a Chinese invasion. Let's watch that.
Combine with that a renewed commitment to our partnership that we may expand with India. Hard commitments to close the Andaman Sea and block the Malacca Strait if required, in the position of potential conflict arising around Taiwan. India would happily do that if we gave them a trade deal that looked similar to what we have already with Chile or Australia.
So, you know, his argument is if India shuts down, you know, that strait, China would be cut out from its energy needs. And so that's an area of leverage that he would implement in order to essentially, it would be a deterrent to an invasion by China, okay? Yeah. So look, again, I have issues with the policy, but let's have a discussion about the foreign policy as he's setting it out, instead of hyper focusing on one tiny part of it to make it appear as though he's just a lunatic who has no real solutions and just wants to put guns in everyone's hands.
Yeah, so look, there's more about the media. So if you're wondering, well, is he being ridiculous or is the media being absurdly biased? The answer is both. Both. So if it was just that CNN thing, you say, okay, look, they said sufficient, they shouldn't have said sufficient, let's move on, right? No, then they go on MSNBC and they ask Bakari Sellers, I think that was CNN again. They asked Bakari Sellers about Vivek and his foreign policy. Now, mind you, they play a clip of him playing tennis without his shirt on, which he purposely put on the internet to get attention, like RFK Jr. He's playing all the tricks, right? Anyways, so they bite into, they get catfished on that. And then Bakari Sellers says, this guy's a lightweight. He's gonna get exposed in the debates because he doesn't know anything about foreign policy, unlike those accomplished politicians. Get out of here. To be fair, Bakari Sellers didn't say unlike the accomplished politicians, but that is this clear insinuation. In reality, that was an interesting foreign policy speech. I think it was ridiculous in that it was wrong and unrealistic and naive, but it's not like he didn't have command of the material. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many times did he mention the Malacca Strait? He seems obsessed by it. And how many other politicians know the Malacca Strait? In that debate, he's gonna get exposed? Nah, you know, look, they're so biased.
But it's not just that they're biased, right? If you exist in a media bubble, like, I don't think Bakari Sellers sat down and watched that speech. I don't think Bakari Sellers has any idea what Ramaswamy's foreign policy is. And the reason why I say that is because if you exist in CNN, where everyone is hyper focusing on this one tiny part of his speech, then you're not getting all the information. And so that arrogant elitism that you hear in that commentary comes from a place of ignorance, which is so ironic because he thinks, no, I know better. Ramaswamy has no idea what he's talking about. He's gonna get crushed in the debates. And finally, I gotta give you one headline from HuffPost, because this is the other thing that drives me crazy. Here's what the headline reads. Vivek Ramaswamy's mansplaining to CNN's Kaitlan Collins riles up critics. Where was the mansplaining?
That's insane. Total insanity. I mean, this is a gift from the gods to Vivek Ramaswamy. They're being insanely biased. So Bakari doesn't do it just out of arrogance and ignorance, which is in plentiful supply for him and the entire crew at CNN, MSNBC, all those dumbass pundits. Oh, the establishment knows best. The politicians are so smart. Oh, outsider, boo, outsider. What we need, no lightweight. Every outsider is a lightweight. Every outsider. It doesn't matter how many degrees they have. It doesn't matter if they're on the right or the left. Bakari Sellers and every pundit on cable television despises every outsider. They're seething about it. Now, the third example I was gonna give was the one Anna just gave about HuffPost. Where the hell's the mansplaining? The guy's a candidate for president. And unfortunately, he's polling third right now in the Republican Party. Ask him about one of his policy positions, even forget that you incorrectly summarize it. You ask him about his policy position, he explains it. And then you call that mansplaining? That's crazy. So can a male candidate not ever explain their policy positions to a female anchor?
If it's a male candidate that they like.
Yeah, this is, no, look guys, this is how they lost all credibility. This is why America can't stand the mainstream media and can't stand this kind of crap. And then what does it do? It makes them accidentally embrace Vivek, because Vivek looks like he's the opposite of that. And much worse, it makes them embrace Donald Trump, because he looks like he's fighting against that. Mm-hmm. And anytime a populist rises up on the left to also challenge the mainstream media and the establishment, but with logical and popular proposals, what do? They send out Bakari Sellers and everyone else and Kaitlan Collins and stuff to look down their nose at them. Go, oh, outsider, lightweight. Our beloved politicians are the ones that are correct. They're the ones that know everything. Do they? The insiders have ruined this country, absolutely ruined it. And instead, you have these clowns here, and they don't even know how to actually attack his proposals that didn't make sense in the first place. But you need to know policy in order to actually execute that. And God forbid that anyone on television should ever learn policy.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks. Really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.